Good evening. Welcome to the Town of Deerfield Select Board, Board of Health meeting on July 29th, 2020. 6 o'clock here at our municipal offices at 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Massachusetts. The dial-in number is 312-626-6799. The meeting ID is 911-604-1580. And the password is 570012. If you want me to repeat that, just call us and we will repeat that. I'm calling the meeting to order. We have a small business home permit public hearing. Are they here, Dick?
Here, yeah.
Okay, then we'll go on to select board announcements. I just want to say that the 350th anniversary committee had a wonderful meeting on Monday, and we are meeting monthly, the last Monday of the month. If anyone is interested, please contact our select board office or email us and let us know so we can appoint you to the committees. Is there any other select board announcements?
Yeah, I can go over a couple things. We were
sure.
So exciting news is the clarifier project at the sewer plant has started. So the crew arrived today. The crane arrives tomorrow morning around 7:30. So they were there today tearing down the old clarifier. And of course DEP is coming around to make sure, you know, they do a yearly kind of what's going on with us. So there's a memorandum that went out today to DEP and copied to us, and it just talked about the different things that we're working on. And I'll just read this so everybody has a, you know, just an update of where we're at now, where we're going. So this is the status of the wastewater systems planning and implementation for the town of Deerfield. As requested to your planned visit on July 30th, 2020, and on behalf of the town of Deerfield, following is an overview of work which is currently active and or plan in the planning stages for the South Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Plant, Old Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Plant, and the town collection system. For the South Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Plant, NPDES permitted, this is the capacity of the plant, is 0.850 million gallons a day, so just under a million gallons a day. The secondary clarifier mechanism identified for replacement December 2017 is currently being replaced. The completion should be the fall of this year. And so again, the crews arrived today. They started work tearing down the clarifier. The equipment is coming, should be in a week or so. The equipment will be here, the new clarifier, which would be great. The crane arrives tomorrow to start pulling the stuff out. So that's really exciting that we can get it done before it gets cold. I think we're on schedule there, which is really great. Then phase one upgrades, this was funded by USDA, are currently in the design phase. They're probably around 50% design at the moment. The upgrades include the headworks improvement, which is a quarter-inch mechanical screening system with washer compactor, new vortex grit capture and pumping processing system, improvement to the biological systems, including a new additional secondary clarifier. So we're not only fixing the one we have, we're actually going to have a secondary for issues like this. Upgrading our UV disinfectant, so going away from chlorine to a UV disinfectant. Ancillary improvements, so building modifications, electrical improvements, new emergency generator. So phase one design phase through early 21, and then construction should be completed by June of 2023. Phase two upgrades are currently in the planning phase, and a plan to address additional needs at the South Deerfield Wastewater Treatment Plant include aeration systems improvements, solids handling improvements, plant water systems improvements, building modifications, site paving. So I wanted to talk a little bit about that today too. And then phase two funding applications anticipated in 2020 and 2021. So the old Deerfield wastewater treatment plant, this is permitted about a quarter of a million gallons a day. Currently in the planning phase, possible upgrades include headworks improvement, new fine screening and influent pumping system replacement, aeration upgrades, new distribution box and aeration system, structural repairs, a new 30-foot diameter secondary clarifiers, UV disinfectant, solid handling improvements, upgrade thickening sludge storage tank, ancillary improvements, you know, new plant water system, HVAC upgrades, building improvements, electrical upgrades, new emergency generator and site paving. So all of that is a ton of work. Or the town is also exploring a regional alternative, which would include decommissioning the old Deerfield wastewater treatment plant and pumping flows to the South Deerfield wastewater treatment plant when that is upgraded for treatment and disposal, or exploring regional partnerships with the city of Greenfield. An additional study is planned for 2021. The collection system, which is all the pipes and everything, phase one and two of the I&I study completed in 2018 and 2019, including collection systems, flow monitoring, manhole inspections, and sonar testing. That's done. The CMOM program and asset management database. This is kind of more DOT, you know, jungle jargon, but it really has to do with the whole database of the whole system, the study. So these were all developed as a result of the phase one and phase two I&I study. The town is currently in year one of its multi-year asset management program, which includes CCTV of the entire collection systems, which is the cameras. So right now we have cameras going out throughout the whole collection system to see what kind of condition the site, you know, all the pipes are in, tributary to both the South Deerfield wastewater treatment plant and Old Deerfield wastewater treatment plant. The town plans to implement improvements to the collection system, including rehabilitation and replacement where necessary of manholes and gravity sewer mains upon completion of the year one program. The overall program is anticipated for the next 10 to 15 years, pending funding availability. So there's a lot there, but that's kind of where we are, a snapshot in time right now. And we have to discuss a bit about phase two and should we go after USDA funding now. And so that costs, you know, $10,000 to $15,000, I guess, to put an application together. I think it's worth it because, you know, with possible change in administration and money towards job infrastructure, I think you're going to see an infrastructure bill either in the next, you know, next time we have a new administration or this one. Once they have done no infrastructure at all for years, so
I agree.
We need to be ready to shovel ready.
So if we did put money for the application, the USDA application, mm-hmm. what we would want, I mean, it's similar information. So it would be collecting the information so we could fill out any mm-hmm. application.
Right.
I mean, that would be part of what we would be paying for,
mm-hmm.
I would hope, so that we can be flexible. And as soon as the infrastructure, I'm sure there is going to be one. I know there is going to be one if Biden mm-hmm. wins. He already said he was going to do it. So we need to have, we need to be ready for this. So we need to figure out, that which should be one of the things on our September
exactly.
town
so
meeting,
that's what I was
that,
saying.
That $10,000 or $15,000. We need to get an actual quote
right.
so that we can get them on board to do that for, you know, at the end of the year.
Yeah, and so we think that's important to do, and that, you know, I wanted to talk to Brenda about the, you know, sewer reserves, and when we set our rates in the fall, we just want to make sure that we're covering that cost and make sure we have that money
right.
ready. The town did approve the $19 million. We're only spending the first $11.4 on the phase one, but we have to get going on phase two as well. There will be a phase three, which is a pipe out to the river and that resiliency work, which I think we can get grant funding.
That will be covered in an MVP or something.
Mm-hmm.
One of the resiliency.
But that's not in one and two, just
right.
so people are clear. That's additional
yeah.
work that we want to do.
But we
there.
Need, well, again, we need to make sure we have a rough estimate of the engineering so
mm-hmm.
it can appear to be shovel ready.
Mm-hmm.
and we can put it in, because there will be a program. There'll be a program for climate change, and there will be a program for infrastructure, so.
We've, you know, with this camera work, and then just, it's summertime, so, you know, horrible language, but Kevin's been knee-deep. Yesterday, he was waist-deep in sewage, because backup sewage, you know, piling out of these pipes that are so old. I mean, literally waist-deep in this stuff all day in 100-degree heat yesterday. The stuff is falling apart. It hasn't been addressed for years. So we're seeing this stuff. We're seeing, milk jugs plugging up a hole. And, I mean, it's unbelievable, you know, how this system is. And so it's time. It's time to do all that stuff. So anyways, I just want to update. I've got other things, but we have a hearing. So welcome.
Yes, thank you very much for coming in. Why don't you introduce yourself, and I will read I got to find the hearing notice.
It's in the pack, Carolyn.
I got it right here. The Deerfield Select Board will hold a public hearing pursuant to Zoning Bylaw Chapter 2242, Section 4650, as filed by Robin L. LaFleur for Home Business Salon at 68 Lee Road. The hearing will be held on July 29, 2020 at 6:15 p.m. Meetings normally held at the municipal offices are being held remotely with adequate alternative means of public access and, where required, public participation provided in accordance with the Governor's March 12, 2020 order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law, MGL Chapter 30A, Section 20. Audience login URL is zoom.us/j/9116041580. The dial-in number is 312-626-6799. Or the one, it's a New York one, is 929-205-6099. That will give you the clearest, if you're dialing in, that will give you the clearest number. The meeting ID is 911-604-1580. Okay. Introduce yourself. And we will.
Wait,
what did you say, Casey? Or?
Oh, add the password for the meeting, please.
Oh, the password. Is it the same password?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Password is 570012. Oh, my gosh.
Now we got all that out of the way.
Okay. So much.
Well, so fun.
All right. So. Thank you both. So, Robin, why don't you introduce yourself?
And I am Robin LaFleur. This is my husband, James LaFleur.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
Good. Why don't you tell us about your operation? We have a packet here, but just for our home audience.
What should I say? I've owned a salon in Northampton for 38 years and looking to come back to Deerfield. My mom is senior, lives with us, having some difficulty, thinking I maybe should be around a little bit more for her. Gonna kind of be retired.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm looking
to
do.
You
work
mentioned
from home.
That there are no walk-ins. It's really your longtime customers.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
So the thing that we're always, from a home business point of view, so you anticipate low traffic.
Yeah, I probably, I don't know.
That road is pretty.
4 or 5 people, maybe.
Yeah. At best, 4 or 5 people a day.
And that's not every day.
Right.
Not every day.
It's currently only 4 days a week, pretty much.
Okay. And with COVID, the only thing I would suggest is your appointment book. Just make sure you have all the contact information in case there's.
Absolutely.
Anyone.
We do that now, yeah.
She has,
you have to wear a mask.
Yes.
The law, the state is requiring it, so she's been doing it since they reopened.
There was also discussion of a holding tank for some of the...
I talked to Mr. Calachestis.
Oh, good.
And I talked to the building inspector about it, and we would have to put in a holding tank, which would hold, it couldn't go into our septic system.
Right.
We don't have an issue with.
Perfect.
And then it would be pumped by somebody like Greg's or Bosley.
Great.
So whenever it gets to the level that it needs to be.
Yeah.
And we're prepared to do that.
Okay, great. That's perfect. I don't have any questions. Does anybody?
Dave, did you have any?
No, I don't have any concerns. It's
we have
like
plenty
a
of parking. Plenty of parking in our driveway.
Yeah.
Quite long.
Is there any questions from anyone that's called in?
Audience questions? No?
Hearing none?
None from the chat.
Oh, okay. Hello? None from the chat? Okay, thank you.
Oh.
Great.
Just got
you never
it.
Know.
Yeah. I didn't quite hear it. okay. Hearing no issues.
Make a motion to close the hearing.
Make a motion to close the hearing.
I'll second it.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Trevor McDaniel.
Aye. Dave Wolfram.
Aye. Carolyn Neff. Now entertain a motion.
I make a motion to approve the home business pursuant to, the regulations. It's going to be the holding tank and all the COVID concerns. And, yeah, I'm good.
Dave Wolfram, I'll second it.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Aye, Carolyn Neff.
Great.
Thank you.
That was easy.
Yes.
The introduction was longer than the meeting.
I know. Sorry.
No.
So what happens now? You issue a permit to us or...
Yes. Unfortunately, our office is closed because of potential COVID exposure. So
I'm aware of that.
Yep.
Tracy, Casey, what are you and Jen? What's the next steps for Robin?
We can pass this along to Pat and have her issue the license.
Okay, great.
Okay.
So.
And how would they pick it up? Are you just going to mail it then?
We can mail it to them, or we can leave it. Well, I would say we should mail it to them, and we may have to get some help from another office to get it out the door.
Casey, because it's my first select board hearing with the town, do you write a decision, not even just the permit? It's just the
not for this one.
Okay.
This, we have a form that we use for home business permits, so we have to follow the hearing process, but the form itself is in the database.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll mail it out.
And then I'll contact Dick and get the what he's going to require for them, us to for the holding tank, and then
yeah, he'd work with you on that for sure.
Yeah.
Help you.
Yeah, I've known Dick for a long time.
Then everything should be okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Nice. Thank you.
We're at home now.
Yeah, it'd be awesome.
We'd love to have you here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye.
Remember me.
Yeah.
I know
we're waiting
for
I know.
Terrible.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Yep. Okay.
That's
bye.
Clapping.
Bye.
Yeah.
Okay. We got that
what's
out
going on in the peanut gallery there.
So was
we're
that
clapping
okay?
for you. This is clapping.
Oh, yeah. Clapping.
So did this work okay? Did we
so
get
far,
checked off
good.
On
we'll have to see if we have any complaints. I think it went fine.
I think I've got a couple.
You do?
So, I do. Well, for some reason, when I go on and pull up through the calendar of the website, that URL is not a hyperlink, and you can't very well copy it on a Chromebook. I don't know how, but anyway, if we had that and the password printed, I don't know if that's allowed, but so everyone had everything in one shot.
Well, honestly, I think what happened was is that I started it with a waiting room, and then I decided, oh, we'll just give a password, but then it changes everyone that I've booked.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
It's welcome to onboarding the system. We're figuring this out. We were testing it yesterday.
just to make it all one-stop shop. Everybody's got every possible thing they need.
Right.
You know, we get there.
Now I'm like, oh, okay. Now I know what went wrong. I just texted Casey and I was like, I know what happened, I think.
Yeah.
because what happened, with the waiting room, I literally have to, if somebody gets booted off or goes off and then comes back, if I don't notice
it
in the waiting room, I have to let them in. So I would rather let everybody in.
Right, right. Yep.
Okay, oh, I see Anna Lee. Okay.
Yep.
Yep.
Trevor, do you want to... Moving on.
Can I finish on a
I was going to ask you just to do an to the school opening, but yes, go do that.
Oh, just a couple things. So I was hitting on this. So the Town Common Ad Hoc Committee met with Berkshire Design Group. Jeff Steyer is his last name. They've been working on the Frontier Track and really enjoyed, you know, working with them there, and I thought, you know, we really want to get the Common going, and I thought it'd be a great idea to just have somebody help us through that process. So we interviewed him, we brought him all of the previous designs that we've done and meeting notes, and we met at the Common, talked about what we wanted to have. So we received a proposal from Berkshire Design Group to help us through the process of you know, designing what we want on the Common, and then I think eventually we're going to need to broaden that out a bit to the other town, you know, the other parts of the downtown, but this is really focused on the Common. So there's a proposal that, you know, I'll send a casing, it'll be available for people to review what we were looking to do. I just wanted to bring this to you because we're going to have a meeting, I think, next week, the Town Common Committee, and they have not seen, I mean, I sent this out, but they have not, we haven't discussed it at all. So I just wanted to get it to you all. There's, you know, if we wanted to move ahead fairly quick, there's a survey and base plan that would be done in, you know, between August 10th and the 14th, a schematic design before September 11th, design development, you know, before October 2nd, there's construction documents and then bidding. Then there's oversight. So there's all different steps that they will take us through, and they split this bid into two options. So we could just do the design part, and then when funding becomes available, we can pick it back up with the construction documents and all of that. But there's a good explanation of what we've, you know, what they would produce and not. And I guess the design work is about $22,750. The construction documents and construction observation is about $8,200. So
okay.
We could look at other.
Don't we have enough money set aside?
We have enough to do this. There's, yeah, that's not, we have more than enough to do this, but I just, you know, if anybody wanted to look at other.
Yes. But how does this fit into the timeline that we had for the grant cycle? For.
We have no grant for the Common, so.
None.
We could go and get a grant. I think there, I would imagine, so there are a couple of things I was looking at with CPA funds, because
yes.
It's, you know, can certainly be used for that. But there's got to be, I wanted to research other grant opportunities, if there's anything else by the state to do with, you know, recreational space.
I was just going to say there's park stuff, but if we're improving it, and we're improving access, which is hugely important.
Oh, absolutely.
And
ADA accessibility, all of that.
You're doing all that. That would be eligible. And
I would think.
Yeah. And
so
it would
the idea
be,
is maybe they could, you know, or get some help to figure out how to go get a grant for that.
Well,
I
that would be part
that.
Of, maybe. I mean, you've got to have a plan so that you can apply.
Exactly.
And then, and that would, if you could get them to fill out the application for small money,
We could add on. If
then I think we should push it through because, I mean, people want to, we need to get this done, number one, for the 350th, okay? We've got to clean up this
and
town.
And just get started on
it. And that's Casey. I want you to make sure you follow up on the Cumberland Farm.
Yes.
Remember the change that October is they run out of time. So we need to keep following up on them.
Yeah. So, you know, it's there for people to review. We'll review it at our committee, you know, next week.
Yeah, Dave, is that all right with you if we start putting this together?
And then we'd come back for approval if you wanted to go ahead with it.
Well, what we want to do is if we can move this ahead a little bit, we can present it to the Capital Improvement Committee and maybe be ready for a September meeting.
Yeah. They said they put an overall budget of like $300,000 to $400,000 for the whole thing. And of course, this is just pie in the sky because we have no idea right now. But that, you know, just based on the understanding of our discussion, what we're looking at, that's the overall scope of the project. But
I think those park
usually they're like 400 grand.
They're up to 400.
Yeah.
I think.
So
you could.
I know we're working on another one for up at the other end.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter.
But
that's a different round.
It is.
It's a different round. So
yeah.
You can apply different rounds.
So
I yeah,
thought it was worth moving forward with, and
yeah,
it seemed like a great.
Let's try to do that.
Okay. Great.
Are they doing any work on the Leary lot at the same time?
So that's a great question. So we had Ty and Bond do the initial design for through the MVP stuff for, I think, I don't know how much they did of the complete streets and the other thing, but I wouldn't mind tying these guys into looking at that. I gave them that work anyway so that they could see the original business association plan from the 90s or late 80s, 90s. That took, you know, a park from Leary Lot onto the common and closing Park Street. It was beautiful. Love to get there eventually, but we're going to have, you know, Leary Lot's mainly parking lot with some pocket parks. But I'd like to have them look at that and see, is there anything we can improve on that design? It was kind of a quick design because it was MVP and they had to get it done fast. But
Casey, when do we hear about the MVP?
I don't know actually when we're going to hear about the MVP. Most of the grant awards are slowed down by at least 2 weeks to a month. We haven't even gotten Green Communities back yet.
Okay.
Okay.
Well,
we
did put it in, so I would say in the, by another month we should know.
Mm-hmm.
And
we
then
should
that
probably
would be
know by the end of August, I would hope.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I think. Then within a month. And that would be in time for the September town meeting as well, because we'd have to formally appropriate our match. But that would give us, I'm hoping that we can do the Leary lot to help Berkshire Brew with, you know,
mm-hmm.
I mean, because the COVID stuff's not going away for a while.
Oh, it's going to be a couple years.
We need to make a more permanent solution for some of our businesses. So getting the Leary lot fixed up and having more outdoor opportunities for our businesses downtown, I think is
mm-hmm.
huge.
Yes.
Yeah.
And there are some business, maybe then we can apply, if we hear that we're successful, then we can move ahead with that and then apply for some of the economic development grants that allow businesses to get recoup with the cost of, you know, like moving outdoors a little bit
mm-hmm.
and stuff. Because we had no takers on that.
Right.
So I did talk to a couple of restaurants downtown, and they were interested. They talked about, I talked to Jake, maybe setting up some seating on the common for people to, you know, come over and eat there. But I don't know who purchases tables, that kind of thing. It gets kind of wishy-washy when it's on town property versus just, you know, maybe in the parking lot in front of their space and blocking off a spot. So I don't know. It takes a lot of work. You know, there's only so much time as a select board member you have. You know, you need public to kind of take the lead on this stuff. I'm stretched thin as it is. So
all of us are. We're spending 50, 60 hours a week.
And our staff is, too. I mean, we're trying to deal with all this other stuff, so it's really hard to take on a bunch of things. But this we've been working on for a long time. I'd really love to just focus on getting that going and tie it into that Leary lot if we can and think long-term about, you know, don't design something that's going to have to get ripped up.
Okay.
So that's that. Did you want an update on school
opening?
Well,
yes. I wanted to, we've met with Deerfield Academy and Eagle Brook. We're working on their reopening plans. They're very responsible
mm-hmm.
and very cooperative, and we're still working on them. People should hear about the school reopening
mm-hmm.
and
that's
going, because Darius has been fabulous.
He's been great. The whole administration there
is delayed, what, 10 days? So
September
13th, so?
Yeah, all the schools, and that was to give teachers some professional development time to kind of get used to teaching in this new environment and the processes that they would have. So the plans that we've been working on, we had to get three to the state. One would be a full everybody back. Probably not going to happen. The other would be a full remote, which may have to happen. The other was a hybrid, which was going to come in a little bit at a time. You know, half the kids come one time, half the kids come the other, and kind of space out everything, do as much outside as you can. And then we were leaving Wednesdays in the beginning few weeks open for professional development so the teachers could figure what did they do right, what did they do wrong. Now that they've negotiated with the state to get 10 days ahead of time, we may not have to do that much professional development those few weeks. So there may be some change to that schedule a bit, you know, so I think they're going to have, the teacher will be able to come back and have no kids there for 10 days to figure out how they're going to do this. We've been, you know, and then I think they're still going to need a few days even into the year as they kind of reassess, okay, now that the kids are here, we better adjust this and adjust that. So there'll be a few professional development days, but there will be some time for, you know, to address getting the kids back in and understanding how this is working. It's not ideal. It's not ideal for families. It's not ideal for the teachers, the kids, but we have to start somewhere, I feel. I think, you know, personally, we have to vote on this next week. We're going to see about that. We still are trying to get, I know you're working through MAPCO on trying to get some indicators of, so you had an outbreak, when do you shut down? When do you open back up again?
Just to understand, there's reopening criteria and closing criteria, and it's depending on the percentage of community spread. Well, for us, we've had, you know, really, we've been wonderfully safe. We have not had truly community spread. It's in the community, but we mostly, most of our cases in the early part of the pandemic have been healthcare workers, and then only recently have we had community members. And but we're still, you know, we're like 14 cases, so it's not like we're rampant or anything like that, and that's over the period of 6 months. So we have to come up with a different criteria. So next Tuesday is another MAPCO meeting. We meet biweekly now instead of weekly. And so we're going to work, I co-chair that. And so we're putting on the agenda discussion to come up with criteria that everyone in the county will agree to. So this is not going to be like a snow day thing that, oh, you know, so-and-so's closing, so we'll all close. This is going to be solid, reasonable, safety issues that we're going to discuss, and we're going to figure out something that works for us as in our rural, more rural communities that are luckily in a bubble.
Not so, the best place you can live.
Yeah,
in
I mean,
right now.
we're the safest.
Yeah.
So,
and we want to keep it that way.
Yeah.
So we want to protect, you know, students and faculty, you know, administration. So it's tricky. There will be no perfect answer. People will be upset one way or the other, just the way it goes. This is probably the hardest decision that we'll make as a Board of Health and school committee will make, administration will make, and we'll have to look back at it. I mean, eventually, you know, if something's not working right, we'll change it. But you have to start somewhere.
It's never, if it's a safety issue, we're 100% on top of it, and, and we're very flexible. So if we have made a decision that it doesn't look like it's working out, we're going to immediately change.
We will.
But
yeah.
if people wear masks, seriously wear masks, and they are unpleasant, but, you know, this is a new reality, and this is really where most of your transmission is happening. So please wear a mask for yourself and others. If you watch your social distancing, you know, try to stay as far apart as you can, you know, comfortably. And also wash your hands and wipe down surfaces and stuff. Then those actions will allow us to support safe reopening and will keep the schools open.
Mm-hmm.
So it's our actions collectively. So collectively, if everyone does this, we will be okay.
Right.
And so it's very important not to let up. I know everybody is sick and tired, and that the highlight of your life is, you know, going to the dump or something. I mean, transfer station. This is, it's tough. There's no question.
That's
so,
the highlight of my weekend.
Yeah. But
not
we got,
so
we
much.
Got, we got to cope. You know, it's going to be another 6 months at least.
Yeah,
if we're lucky, we will have a vaccine sometime in, you know, later winter. We're meeting as the EDS group. We're meeting weekly. Now we're biweekly. We have some planning meetings. So again, September 30th at the Senior Center, when you drive through and pick up your food, you can get your shots. That's where you can get the super duper, you know, the high strength flu shot or a regular flu shot. It's up to you. And we'll be sending out the forms pre-register, but you can do that at the Senior Center. That's September 30th. October 4th at the Deerfield Highway Garage, we are going to set it up like we would have to run a COVID clinic, you know, drive-through in the winter. So you're going to see us practicing what we need to set up to provide you all with COVID vaccine when it's really cold. So help us by, if you're interested in volunteering, there's going to be plenty of jobs. We will have help. We have good volunteers, but we need more volunteers, especially we want people to be have the opportunity to understand what we're doing. We haven't run an EDS. Our EDS we did for 8 years in a row, but we haven't done it for 6 years. So we have not had free vaccine. So what we need to do is practice the flu. So come get your flu shot and help us practice. But also, if you're interested, come and volunteer. You'll get your COVID shot first. And, I mean, there is some advantages of volunteering. And also, you're going to have an idea of how we're going to run this and help us work out all the kinks so that we can do this. Please send your information to our Select Board office if you're interested. And also, Dave's wife, Mary, is organizing the volunteers as well. So we'll be working on this for, you know, the next few weeks. But if you're interested in helping, please step forward.
Yeah, we definitely need the help, for sure. Healthcare workers, anybody that wants to, you know, nurses.
There's plenty of non-medical jobs.
Yeah,
but
if you have
a nursing license and you don't mind giving shots, that would be very helpful.
You do help.
Okay.
Great.
Dave, did you have any announcements or anything? It's just lovely to see you back, by the way.
Yeah, it's okay to be back.
Good.
It's, you know, it's been a little bit longer haul than I had planned on, but it's...
I'm glad you're feeling better.
Yeah. So it's still got a couple of 4 weeks before I'm really back to speed, but, you know.
Okay. You're here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So the only thing I want to kind of mention is the you know, I just want to compliment Chief Pachurik on the way he handles the Deerfield Police Department.
Yeah.
Hear.
Yeah.
You know, there's been a lot of things going around and about the police and everything, and it's just, you know, there's bad apples in every group. I don't care what group you're in. But our chief has been very diligent. He has very good systems set up.
Good training.
You know.
Excellent training.
Quite frankly, the thought process of defunding police departments is just a bunch of crap. You know, it's just, if anything, you know, we have to look at re-educating our forces more.
Mm-hmm.
So it's putting more money into them instead of taking it away. And making sure it's done the right way, so.
Actually, Dave, John, I was going to have John come and talk about what's happening on the state level, but since the bill was still in conference and we don't really know the outcome yet, he's actually on the agenda for August 12th.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for bringing that up, just so that people do know that. We are concerned about this, but we are so lucky, as Dave says, to have a good police chief
and a police department. Yeah, he's been amazing. We have a Deerfield Inclusion Group, and immediately reached out, got together. I've been on a meeting with him and Jen Bartek, Chief Sergeant Jen Bartek, has been very involved in that, and any rallies or demonstrations, that he's been right on the ball and offering his services and the people of his staff there to make sure that people are safe and welcome and understand that, you know, what they can do, what they can't do, and how they can, you know, get volunteers to help direct traffic and all of that. So he's just been there nonstop on his day off, on his time off, you know, July 4th, everybody's enjoying their vacation,
and
he's here working. So he's been doing a really good job, and he's, and I think, you know, what happens and people kind of want change, it's helpful to then, you know, first come get an education on what is the norm now. You know, you want to change, so okay, let's look at what our use of force is and the proactive training that we do now, and everybody can always improve, and I think he says right off the bat, we're always willing to improve and look at new ways to do things and adjust, and so definitely on the forefront of trying to make sure our part-time officers, full-time officers are trained and know what to do and how to de-escalate. You know, we don't do choke holds, all that kind of thing that, you know, they're asking for is already, we're light, Massachusetts is light years ahead, and Deerfield, because of Chief Pachurik, is way ahead on that.
And, you know, it's, I served for 14 years on the police department here in Deerfield, and look at the training I had here. And compared to what they do now,
mm-hmm.
it's light years ahead.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just, you know,
yep.
it's just amazing.
It is. And I think
what, you know, we require of police officers these days, what's expected of them,
yep.
It's just, you know.
It is a lot on their shoulders.
There is. And it's just, you know.
Just like our teachers. There's a lot on their shoulders.
Yep.
They're dealing with.
Well, everybody is doing more social work.
Yes. And, you know. Actually, I feel good for the teachers because most of these parents are going to have their kids home for quite a while, and they're thinking, okay, this is the way they're behaving at home. Let's start straightening them out before they get back to school.
The last time anyone's going to vote down a school budget, I'll tell you that.
Yeah. I don't think the school department's going to have any problems with their budgets.
No. Take the kids back, please.
Yeah.
No, you're right. I'm glad you mentioned that because it's true. He's been doing great, and he has been working with all those groups and trying to be out front and talking with them.
He's been really the forefront of a lot of things. He also participates in a lot of groups, and that is very helpful. He represents us really well. Mm-hmm. Very well. Moving on, we have a consent agenda on the minutes.
We didn't finish them.
Okay.
We didn't finish them.
Okay. Good.
Welcome to COVID.
No, that's all right. I just didn't see him. So I'm like, did you see him? Okay. Discussion and decision items. Casey, we authorized the chair and Trevor. You wanted to do this again? Okay.
Yep.
So how do you want us to clean it up?
So I would make a motion to approve. Well, if you still want to have me sign the warrants, and then the chair is always authorized to sign the warrants as an alternate, or I guess I would be the alternate, I've always felt the chair always has the right to sign the warrants.
Oh, yeah.
And then
you have to specifically vote it.
So we'll specifically vote that.
You do have to specifically vote it. So they authorized you in the last vote they took, Trevor. They authorized you to be the signatory, but we ran into a problem when we weren't able to get you here. So a secondary authorization would be perhaps to have the chair sign or to have the chair and the town administrator sign, however you guys want to handle it. It's just have a backup in case somebody can't get here.
Yeah, but Casey, we voted the Trevor and the chair.
No, you didn't.
Just wanted to
I went back and I listened to it. It was just Trevor.
Oh, was it? I could have sworn it was
just
the chair.
The chair always had the right.
All right.
Yeah.
I don't have any member.
You physically have to vote it.
We did. Well, anybody can. Yeah.
So how do we want to set that up that any member can
any one member? Because what if Trevor and I are not available and it's Dave? Or what if I'm the only one available and Dave's chair?
May I make a suggestion?
Twofold
thing. Have two people be able to sign. Perhaps a member of the select board and the town administrator, or a member of the select board and the town accountant. Select so you have two only. People looking at it.
No, I kind of only want the select board too. How about any member of the select board?
Okay, as long as you vote it.
Okay. I'm
any one member of the select board may sign in the event that Trevor's not available. Did you want to phrase it like that?
Well, Trevor volunteered to be the point person to make sure someone is always checking. But if he's not available, I would like to make the motion that it's any select board member at any point can be the one that signs. So we won't name Trevor. We won't name the chair. We just name anyone, one, any one of us. Is that okay?
Yeah. I thought that's the way it always had been.
I did too, actually. But then we re-voted it for Trevor and the chair.
But I guess maybe we didn't make that clear.
Because you were moving on from chair.
No, when I listened to it, because I thought you did too, but when I listened to it, it just said Trevor. The vote was specific to Trevor. So if you want to change that so that any one member of the select board can, I think you have to give a clarifier though as a secondary, because one of the reasons that they want that the MGL requires the select boards to review the warrants is to make sure that things are getting paid appropriately.
Correct.
Right.
So
that's
the reason you have to take a vote in the first place.
Trevor volunteered to go through every single bill, and then if he's not available, which he does, but then any one of us can come in and look at it as well, but it's not necessary for us to sign it. But if Trevor's not available, any one of us should be able to fill in behind him and commit, making sure that someone is looking through every single bill.
Okay. So I'm going to say any member of the select board may review and sign the warrant if Trevor is not available.
Perfect.
As a motion.
Well, is that good, or would you rather it's something else? Or you just rather it because... Again,
we can just... why do we have to say if Trevor's not available? Well, can't we just say any...
Because you, theoretically, you should have a quorum signing it unless you decide that it's okay. And so this is what I'm asking. Is it okay for any one member to sign the warrant? That's what I need to know.
Yes, we decided that 2 or 3 years ago because it was hard to track down all three of us sometimes in the summer or when somebody was sick. I don't know what it was. Somebody was not available and then somebody was out of town and it was like there was only one person. So I thought we decided that already.
Well, we voted one person. Any one member can sign. Maybe the chair would be the one to sign and then any one member can sign?
No, don't say chair because you're the one you already volunteered to go through every single bill. Somebody should be looking at every single bill.
Yeah.
Well, you have a town accountant that reviews every single bill before it even turns into a warrant.
Yeah.
I know. She is wicked good.
That's who I go to ask.
Yes, she's wicked good, but I kind of just want it to be any one of us. Trevor's volunteering, but we don't need to say that. He's just doing it for now. And
right, but you initially voted him, so if you want to change that, then let's clarify what this means, because what I would say is any one member of the select board may review and sign the warrant if quorum of the select board isn't available. Maybe you do it that way.
That's fine.
That works.
All right.
Yeah.
Does that make you happy?
That's fine.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
So make a motion that any one member of the select board may review and sign the warrants if a quorum is not available.
Dave Wolfram, second.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Trevor McDaniel.
Aye. Dave Wolfram.
Aye. Carolyn Nutt. Okay. Casey?
Okay, that's clear. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, no, I really thought.
No, it's fine. I just want to make sure that we're clear.
Yep. No, that's
because
good.
It'll be helpful in the treasurer's office.
Yeah. No, I'm sorry. I thought it was clear before. Next item on the agenda is a retirement letter from Mike Phillips. He'd just like to take the opportunity to inform us that his retirement is effective at the end of August 10th, 2020, end of the workday. He's been here for 37 years.
Thank you.
And we just want to appreciate how much, that's a lot of snow plowing in the late, late night.
Just think about that, how many things he's done and seen and changes and support he's given to the residents of this town for 37 years. That's a long time.
That's a wicked long time.
You know, a lot like, you know, Harry Ruddick, all the years that he's given to our community. And I'm so grateful for all the work Mr. Phillips has done for his department and for all the residents. And all the things that he's, you know, helped people with over the years has been great.
So do we have a motion to accept his letter?
Yes, and make a motion to accept Mike Phillips' letter of retirement on the last, the end of the day. The last working day is August 10th, 2020.
Dave Wolfram, second.
Is there any further discussion? We just want to make sure it's clear in the record that we appreciate all the years that Mike has worked for the town and
absolutely
all those terrible snowstorms, 37 winters of snowstorms.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, thank you, Mike. All those in favor?
Aye, Sarah McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Aye, Carolyn Ness. Thank you so much, Mike, and I'm hoping
to wish you a very restful retirement.
Yeah, a good time to retire, at least not since
we're jealous
the winter of. Another winter. Okay, next item on the agenda is the Greenfield participation letter for the community block grant small business loan. Casey, do you want to just give us an update on this?
Yes, so this was a grant that Greenfield went after on behalf of all the towns that wanted to participate. And Robin Fordham had sent an email about it. I forwarded it out. It was several weeks ago. But then MJ Adams got in touch with me about it. She now works for Greenfield. So I asked MJ for a letter, but I haven't heard back from her. And what this would allow us to do is pass on any grant amount availability to businesses that might need that. And we have two, if you look in the
list.
I think it's the third page of that section.
Yep.
You'll see that we had two, I think we have two grant awards of up to $10,000. So I had asked MJ to send me the letter, participation letter, but she hasn't gotten back to me. So I'm wondering if the board would be willing to approve that letter and sign it, have the chair sign it upon receipt.
Sure, I make that motion.
Jay Wolfram, second.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Nope. Thank you, Casey, for pursuing this for the COVID.
Thank
you know,
Robin. Thank Robin and MJ. They did all the work. I'm just trying to facilitate.
Right.
They did a lot of hard work. I think that's very kind of them to share.
Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely.
If there's any further discussion, I'll. All those in favor?
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Aye, Carolyn Ness. Great. Maybe how are you going to notify people that or businesses that
That's what I want to find out from Robin and MJ, how they're handling it. So there's more information they're going to have to send out to us.
Okay, because there might be
having you participate.
There might be additional help too as well.
That's what we're waiting to see.
Yeah, so make sure, we have
so what I would do is I would send this out online and maybe do see whether it makes sense after I talk to Robin and MJ to see how they're going to notify their towns and maybe we'll follow their lead.
Okay. So the next item on the agenda is to name Casey as or the town administrator as the ADA coordinator.
You need one more thing to do, don't you?
Yeah, I'm sure. Oh,
Kevin's totally. Kevin is happy, though.
That he's losing his job.
He's still helpful. I got to say, he passes me more information than I necessarily need.
Okay.
He's probably seriously texting me and telling me to shut up, too.
So, thank you.
I make that motion to appoint Casey as or the town administrator is the ADA coordinator.
Thank you.
Dave Wolfram, second.
Is there any further discussion?
Nope. Thank you, Casey.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
And thank you, Kevin, for doing it for so long.
Yes, and I, Carolyn.
Yes.
Contracts. Casey, what contracts do you have for us?
So the only contract I have for you is the contract, and I honestly don't know if I remember to get it out for you, but it's in the office. So it's a contract to accept the streetlight collaborative work we do with MDOT. We have to maintain that our accesses are appropriate, and we're maintaining those accesses as they cross streetlights. Plus, we have the ability to change, allow the ambulance to go through, or the fire trucks to go through, the police officers to go through the lights with the clickers. So there's a contract for that. I think it's in the office, right?
No, we have it. You have it out in the packet.
Oh, okay. Yep, I didn't put it out. Oh, my God.
Agreement. Yep.
So we ask you to, we're voting to have you authorize to sign it, right?
Yes. The town administrator signs, and then the highway administrator, Mass Highway. Yes. Okay.
Yeah, Mass Highway.
All right.
And then it looks like Casey, Lisa would sign, town solicitor.
Yeah. I make a motion.
And she has a copy of it.
Okay.
Yeah, I make a motion we approve the traffic control agreement and authorize town administrator's sign for us.
Second, Trevor McDaniel.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Aye, Carolyn Ness. Okay. Select board policy.
We don't have any.
Policy?
Not to.
Okay.
COVID.
Do you want to address the memorandum?
It's not, I'm going to do those under not anticipated.
Oh, okay.
Not
wait.
Today. Okay.
The next item on the agenda is a letter of support for a small grant the Franklin Conservation District has applied for. If we get the MVP 5 round on healthy soils, it will be used as a match towards our efforts to do a circuit rider. And our circuit rider grant is to go to farms and landowners and sign them up for programs and NRCS money programs. NRCS doesn't have enough staff to spend the money that's allocated to Massachusetts. So we're applying for a grant, which I hope we get. And that could be, we got a match from the Massachusetts Association of Conservation Districts, which I am president, and I am, full disclosure, chair of the Conservation District. So that's how I knew about our MVP program. So the idea is hopefully we're bringing more money back into the valley, that will be conservation, erosion control, buffers, no-till, that kind of stuff. And that's part of our healthy soils is encouraging no-till because carbon sequestration is one of the big climate change fighters. So anyway, it's all related. And so I was hoping you would support
this. So make a motion, to approve this letter of support.
Or to sign the letter of support.
Oh, to sign the letter of support.
I'll second that. Dave Wolfram.
You want to read it or?
No. I was just going to say
so
that.
So we received that request back last week and had to have an emergent. They needed it in emergency time frame.
Right.
So if the motion could have a friendly amendment to be approved as of July 23rd, which was Thursday when they needed it.
I'll make that motion to approve as of July 23rd.
Okay. If there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Trevor
McDaniel. Aye.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
And I'm going to abstain because I'm chair of the Conservation District and president of MACD, which also sent a match letter, so it just
makes sense.
Looks better if I don't. I signed it because I approve it, but I just...
No, it's fine.
Abstain from the vote.
I'm going to go on.
sewer abatements. We don't have any, do we,
no.
Casey?
No.
We have mail. Speaking about the feasibility of studies, can I just ask you, Casey, more, have you heard anything from the FERCOG on that technical assistance grant that they were supposed to be doing inventory of the culverts?
No, I haven't. I know they did do, I know they were working on it, but I haven't asked Megan about that. Megan and I were spending a lot of our email time talking about the ADA work. So I will send Megan an email and ask her.
Okay. The reason why I want is because I'm really want us to have our culverts organized and have a priority list of at least 4 or 5 culverts that we want replaced.
Right.
So if there's any kind of infrastructure project or climate, you know, climate resiliency program or whatever that we can apply, I want to make sure our culverts, we have culverts that are ready to go. I mean, we have a couple things on River Road that we know are problematic, but,
mm-hmm.
you know, there are some problematic places down here in South Deerfield. We have the one in the old Deerfield and Deerfield along the Deerfield River that I got done under the Irene kind of grants, but we haven't done the ones down here, and we haven't finished River Road.
Well, I stuck in, Casey doesn't know this yet, but I stuck in the Mass DOT report. We get emails, I'm not sure if everyone else gets them too, but we get emails from Mass DOT when they come out and do culvert and bridge inspections.
Bridge, yeah,
so I've been
bridge
inspections. Yes, I've been keeping a file of those just on the computer. Just whenever we get them, I stick them in a folder. But I just thought I would print this one. This was Stockbridge Road and the Mill River. This is, I think, the second time I've seen this since I've been select board, and these nuts on this thing have not been replaced yet. So I wanted to get somebody out to just put those on there, like address, like the photos that are in here. I know we can't address everything, but we can trim back some of the vegetation around the guardrail and put these nuts on here. That's all there. It's just missing some nuts from the guardrail. That's all. And then weed whack back the thing, just to protect what we do have, you know, because this looks fairly new.
It is new, and it was
new.
A pain in the neck.
It was 2003 we replaced that, right, Carolyn?
Yes,
2003.
That was a huge hassle.
It was huge because you did Hobby and Stockbridge at the right at the same time.
We had to post fire trucks on one side and then the other side.
Yep.
Oh my God.
So, Trevor, if you leave a copy for Kevin, that would be helpful because I haven't seen that report.
Okay, I'll do that. I'll leave a copy for him and then just circle what needs to get done. It'd be good to just kind of keep it in good shape, you know.
Okay.
So.
Thank you.
All right. Yeah.
I'll check in with Megan.
Okay.
So the culvert grant, I just want to make sure you follow up on Casey and Cumberland Farms. I know we mentioned it, but I just really want to make sure that's on the tickler because we're running out of time. Is there anything else you wanted to talk about on your administrator's report?
I just wanted to let you know that we submitted, thanks to Jennifer's very hard work with Chris Curtis and Andrew Smith, we've submitted the final reports for the tasks that we've completed in MVP 19 and 20. Now, most of 20 was pushed off to 21, but we went through the tasks, we went through our matches, we got the reports from Brenda, and we pulled all the copies of the bills together and sent that to Andrew after Chris looked at it. And he gave us some comments back. And so we finalized the MVP 20 report this afternoon with Andrew on the phone. And so we're hoping to hear affirmatives from him. But a lot of the work that we had to continue or extend into 21, we will work with him more on that as we progress through it, like Kelleher, Mill Village. We'll do those completions later. But it was a lot of hard work, and I have to give Chris and Jennifer a lot of credit for all that work they did.
And you.
So thank you very much. Was this MVP 3 and part of 4?
Yes. We actually had 3 years of open grants that we just basically closed. We're almost closed with 19, and what we completed in 20 seems small until you realize that there's a lot of work in process right now that'll be completed by October.
Okay, sounds wonderful. Did you have any questions, Dave?
Nope.
Okay.
I don't.
All right,
I
we
do
have two.
Another thing. I was on the COVID CEO call and I wanted to alert everybody. So this CEO call is one that's hosted by MMA biweekly and it's now going to monthly. When COVID started, it was a weekly call. And what the Lieutenant Governor updated us on was reopening phases and the new travel orders. So the new travel orders may have some HR impacts that I will circle back around to you about because the travel orders are could have impacts with people's vacations and any collective bargaining agreements we have. So I'm good. As soon as I get some information from the state, which is what Lieutenant Governor Pulido promised, was to send us their guidance, their HR guidance, because of course the state has a lot of unions. So they're going to send out HR guidance so that MMA can share it with the mass managers. So when I have more information, I'll circle back around to you in case the select board needs to make any decisions about that or if we have further follow-up we have to do. But the other thing that she talked about, and she was very specific about it, we had DESE updates, and I think Darius shared most of that with you all in individual calls. Really, the DESE's waiting for their plans to be the plans from the districts and the schools to be finalized. I think they're all due on Friday. But one of the things that she mentioned was they're continuing to evaluate the feasibility of reopening libraries and senior centers because right now their stance on that has been these are the most critical. There's an interaction of critical illness populations, so that's been the reasoning to not open senior centers and libraries. And I just wanted to make sure that I advise the select board that this physically came out of Lieutenant Governor Pulido's mouth, that they are not in favor and they won't approve their own reopening change to include senior centers and libraries quite yet because they want to watch the numbers and community spread and see how we end up with treatment and vaccine availability, just like they're watching with the schools.
Right. I've had three conference calls on the travel forms, and
yes.
We'll be able to cope with those. They're sending them to the Community Tracing Collaborative,
yes.
And it will be able to be viewed. We do not physically have to handle them as Boards of Health or as Town Hall staff. So
yes.
That was what I was really concerned about.
So were we.
I was concerned.
Thank you.
I was not getting our accurate information, but this afternoon's conference call clarified that. I asked the question, had a discussion with Jenna Ferguson, who runs most of these meetings and calls, and so it's all set. So we'll be able
Thank
to handle
you, Carolyn.
It.
And if you get any other information, let me know because there's a lot of questions flying around on the HR listserv and on the STAM listserv because we're all trying to figure out how to deal with it because we're in the middle of vacation season.
I know. Well,
vacation in Massachusetts.
I know.
Right?
So supposedly we're going to be
able to. A
lot of
nice places to go hiking.
Yeah. Anyway, Casey, I haven't had.
Protect yourself from ticks.
Yeah, you got ticks and everything else. You notice I didn't mention ticks or mosquitoes yet.
I hadn't heard it yet. That's why
I was waiting.
I was going to see how long our meeting is.
Too long already.
Anyway, Casey, I haven't had a chance to look at this IT study, feasibility
study. That's okay.
Study.
It's just there for your information.
Okay.
When I have more information or if you want to see the full report, let me know because the full report's bigger. And I would probably want to get it from the COG and print it for you.
No, that's all right. It's meaningless to somebody like me. But I really want to make sure that we're doing as much as possible. So could we put this on the agenda further on, to discuss at some point?
Okay, we've got some things that are coming up. I know you and I both have a cybersecurity meeting next week. We have a follow-up to the first cybersecurity Zoom meeting we had, Carolyn. I think it's on the 6th. So it might be worthwhile to go through that second cybersecurity meeting and then look at this stuff. Because essentially what the feasibility report says is if we want to leverage money to the best of all the town's advantages that are in the COG and are interested in doing this, and there's quite a few of them, if we want to leverage our money best, then the best way for us to do that is to go through a process of evaluating standards that are scalable, using economies of scale for purchases, and being flexible in how different towns with different needs utilize that information and that accessibility for purchases or monitoring or however we handle it, to meet their own needs, because different towns have different needs. I mean, I watched Shelburne go through somewhere in the neighborhood of $75,000 infrastructure implementation plan because they lost one element of their technology system that oversaw the assessor's records. And 5 years ago this happened. It was massive. And so that's actually what started some of this feasibility work. But basically they said we need to be cognizant of how we're moving forward, and if it makes sense to do it regionally, which they think it does, then let's figure out how to make a scalable, economically feasible plan for all the towns to buy into in some elemental way.
Well, we're sponsoring cybersecurity at Homeland Security too. We're spending money on projects, so
right.
I just want to make sure. Seriously, my eyes glaze over, so it's really tough for me to be able to be sure. But I want to make sure what we're doing in this is being complemented by what we're doing in Homeland Security, because, you know, I put us in for the pilot project, and
right.
And that is going to move forward probably at the beginning of next year. So
yeah.
We want to make sure that we're taking advantage of as much as possible. Even though I
is
hate this stuff,
involved
it doesn't
in that,
matter. We
Carol?
Need to do it. What?
Is Rain involved in that?
Yes.
Rain up
yes.
at the COG? So she was on the
yes.
meeting. So I think she's representing that group in this feasibility
yes.
evaluation.
Right.
If
well,
that makes you feel better.
We set aside some money last year and this year, so it's accumulating, and I want to make sure that Deerfield is taking advantage of that, because there is a lot
Absolutely.
Of malware and ransomware issues out there, and I want to make sure that we're, you know, protected as much as possible.
And so that was actually one of the biggest takeaways from their feasibility study. If you dig into it, I think it's this first few pages in, is cybersecurity is the most critical thing. And so we need to see cybersecurity as a true omnibus budget item. It's no longer a capital item, and we need to fund it in that manner. That's their recommendation, because if we don't and we get hacked, it's going to cost us more money to fix the hack. And remember, we were in that cybersecurity meeting, and the lawyer said that. It's going to cost us more money if we don't build our infrastructure than it will if we do.
Well, that's why I wanted Homeland Security to pay for our basic stuff. So anyway, whatever.
So we'll continue working on it. When I have more information, I'll let you know.
Okay. I know we're coordinating on it, and I appreciate it, because, like I say, I'm not really interested, except that I know it costs money, and we have exposure, so I'm hustling the money,
right.
even though I hate the stuff. Anyway, okay, moving on. Public comment?
Okay.
Is there any public comment? Okay.
This is Chris Harris. I'm fine with everything, and thank you all for your efforts and progress.
Thanks for always attending, Chris.
Oh,
really,
Chris,
appreciate
thank
it.
You for always calling in. It's really nice that somebody really cares.
You're welcome.
We feel loved.
We do put a lot of effort into this stuff, seriously. You know, like, this year, like all day. Okay, we have two unanticipated items that came up today. We have had a couple of complaints in town that we haven't been able to resolve, so we need to vote to authorize the Board of Health and its agents to shut down businesses for non-compliance of use of facial covering. So I move to authorize the Deerfield Board of Health and the Board of Health agents to close any businesses and/or public accessibility activities for noncompliance with Governor Baker's Order Number 31, Appendix of COVID-19 Order 13, extended by COVID Order 21 and 30, requiring the use of facial coverings until such time as the businesses and/or public accessibility activity has met compliance standards.
I'll second that motion. Trevor McDaniel.
Is there any further discussion?
No, I think everybody needs to set the right example. We are low here because of the, I mean, this is a broken record now, but please wear face masks, stay distance, set an example for community members, set an example for our children. You know, all these kids are going to be going back to school. We'll discuss this in a minute, but you need to be, as an adult, setting an example for the kids that this is what you do to make sure that you are doing everything you can to make sure our businesses can stay open and that kids are able to go back and get educated and, you know, you can go get food and you could, you know, all kinds of things that we're, you know, that we're enjoying, luckily, a little bit more now that we're opened up. You know, you have to play by the rules or else we'll all get shut down again.
I just can't emphasize enough, these actions, wearing a mask, will support safer reopening going forward, including the school, and it will help the school stay open and it will help our businesses stay open. Our businesses need our support, and our community needs our support by wearing masks, so please wear masks. So all those in favor?
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfen.
Aye, Carolyn Ness. I know we sound like broken records, but it seriously is important. Okay, Trevor, this came up in our emergency dispensing call this morning, so yes. Would you just like to explain why we're doing this?
Yeah, so this is another memorandum from the Board of Health requiring all face masks to be worn at school. Clearly, the wearing of masks is an important aspect of mitigation of the spread of virus. With that in mind, we must be cognizant of the need to plan for structured mask breaks frequently and safely during the school day. The following safety information is provided to make sure that, that we're voting here to require face mask covering in all schools. This is to support the administration and to, again, make it as safe as possible for everybody. The move to require face coverings as follows. Wearing masks is required for all people who bring students to and from schools. During arrival and dismissal, all students are required to wear masks. Students in grade 2 and above will be required to wear face masks. Students in preschool, kindergarten, and grade 1 will be encouraged to wear face masks as appropriate for that age range. Please see, there's a link, how to help your child adapt to wearing a mask. Face covering should be worn by all students when in halls and common areas, especially during any transition times. Face masks are an accepted alternative. Face shields are an accepted alternative for specialized populations of students who would be unable to wear a traditional face covering. All adults are required to wear face coverings at all times in the building. Transportation staff are required to wear masks during bus van transportation. Students will be reminded verbally and visually with signs and other nonverbal cues to not touch masks to wash their hands frequently. Learning and following through with our robust hand washing procedures are essential to the health and safety of our community members. Information will be provided to staff, students, and students' families on proper use, removal, and washing of masks. Teachers and staff will provide regular mask breaks throughout the day with proper social distancing, 6 feet, ideally outside when appropriate, or with open windows in learning spaces. Schools will have disposable masks available to students and staff and limited supply of cloth face coverings. However, families will be expected to provide face coverings for their children.
transparent masks provide the opportunity for more visual clues and are being considered for both staff and students, especially for students with social emotional delays and other special needs. So
I will second that, Trevor.
Thank you.
Is there any further discussion?
No, not at all. It's very important part of the aspect, especially bringing our students back, because at the, most of these students will be asymptomatic,
mm-hmm.
and it's not really the students, it's when they go home to their parents and grandparents that this could be transferred, and it's important to try to limit that as much as possible.
Yep.
I agree.
You know, I know some people believe in herd technology, but, you know, quite frankly, being a senior citizen, I hate being that part of the herd.
So this is really to support our administration so that they can enforce this rule.
This is, and yes, this will
Board
be
of Health, and I think every other Board of Health in the district will be doing the same
right.
as we are.
But this is for our schools in our town. So if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye, Trevor McDaniel.
Aye, Dave Wolfram.
Aye, Carolyn Ness. Thank you.
You.
These are both items that came up today. Our upcoming meetings are August 12th and the 26th, September 9th and the 23rd, October 7th and the 21st, November 4th and the 18th, and Casey has taken care of the holidays, thank you, December 2nd, 16th, and 3rd.
They all fell that way, Carolyn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it was no hassle, so yes, I'm all set. Just to let everyone know. Okay.
As long as you have time to make sticky buns around the holidays, we're good. Want to make sure
you
have plenty of time.
Can I just say one more thing?
Yes.
We have to investigate. So the legislature just made Juneteenth an official holiday, so I'll get you more information about it. I just saw it circling on the HR listserv again.
Today.
Oh, okay. It's today.
Yeah.
All right, wonderful.
Today. So okay. That means we'll end up having to figure out how that works into the holidays. Because
yeah,
if it's an official state holiday like Patriots Day, then we're required to give that time off somehow. I don't know quite what that looks like yet.
Okay, we'll figure that out for people, for sure.
Sorry about that. Well, I meant to say that earlier.
No, I will mention mosquitoes real quick. Make sure you wear bug spray and watch your activity at dusk and dawn, because we've had no mosquitoes test for anything in Deerfield. We've been extremely lucky. Kevin's been out putting dunks out and stuff. So hopefully West Nile, we've made it. For the first time, this was the 8th year of our data collection, and we've had no West Nile disease. Normally, it pops up the first week of July, so not this year.
That's good.
And no triple.
It's been dry, too.
Yeah.
I mean, we've had some downfalls here and there, but pretty dry, which is, you know.
And please watch the ticks. Permethium is the thing that you can spray on your legs. There's an awful lot of ticks out there. And with this rain, when it's dry, the ticks tend to pull back under the leaf mold and try to keep moist. But when we have regular rain showers, they come out more. So please be careful if you're out hiking in the woods. Okay? I will take a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
I'll second that. Dave Wolfram.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye. Trevor McDaniel.
Aye. Dave Wolfram.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Carolyn.